So just a brief comment and before Andy starts. Over those 3 days, there were a number of references to the topics that we'll be discussing in this session. To negotiations, why civil resistance is ongoing, and to transition, when civil resistance is eventually successful in reaching its main objective, what happens then afterwards. So we will be picking up on the themes that you yourself raised and a number of speakers and presenters touch upon and trying to kind of bring them together. So Emmy will focus specifically on negotiations and interplay between civil resistance and negotiations, whereas I will pick up on the remaining part of civil resistance and transition.
Thank you. I'm thrilled to be back. I was actually a participant in the first FSI in 2006 and then had the chance to come back in 2010. And I'm just really grateful for the opportunity to be here today. I've always found this really inspiring and motivating leadership role to be with. So my goal for this short session is to really just introduce some of the possibilities and framework of negotiation as a tool for civil resistors, as a viable tool of which civil resistors can draw upon. I'm not trying to present negotiation as a comprehensive solution for all civil resistance struggles at all times, so I just want to be really clear about that. This is a tool that I think could perhaps be helpful in some scenarios. So I guess I just wanted to start with, like, what is negotiation? Some of you may have been trained in it or participated in negotiation before. If I could just get maybe one or two, you know, ideas of what do you associate with negotiation?
Conversation between two.
Any
specific agenda or issue.
I'm sorry?
Any specific agenda or issue.
Okay.
Conversations.
Great. So it's a conversation, it's dialogue between at least two parties. Yep. Yep.
Compromise.
Okay.
Bargaining.
Yeah, I think it's just a clever way of trying to get what you want without offending the other party.
Without offending the other party. All right. Excellent. Well, just as there are misconceptions about nonviolent action, which Hertzschak has illustrated well for us, there are misconceptions about negotiation, and I just want to sort of highlight a few of them because I'm hoping that we can go a little bit beyond those. So the first is really that negotiation is only about compromise or about concessions. It's about, you know, cutting the difference 50-50. And so in this scenario, most of us who are in civil resistance struggles are going to be very concerned about going into a negotiation because we want the whole piece of the pie. We want to get all of our goals met. And so when we enter a dialogue where we're only going to get some of them or half of them, it's a bit dangerous. And in fact, Gene Sharp, wrote a whole chapter in From Dictatorship to Democracy illustrating the dangers of negotiation. And I think he very well articulates some of the concerns around negotiation being only about concessions or about sort of this splitting the difference. The next piece is that, you know, negotiation is not, it has no framework around justice. It's just, it's just about agreement and about appeasement and conciliation, and it doesn't really have a framework of justice. And when in fact, I think there are lots of examples of negotiation being used throughout a struggle in which justice has been a critical component, particularly the anti-apartheid struggle in South Africa. And then the third here is just that it's a ceremonial function. It's just sort of this big fancy thing we do at the end of a struggle, and that's the space for negotiation, in which I would argue that negotiations happen throughout a struggle. There are multiple negotiations that we are carrying on within our movements, with coalitions, within each other, within individual activists and parties, as well as sort of towards the end when you might be transitioning and more directly negotiating with an opponent. So just some definitions here. I think you guys sort of touched upon its most basic form, one of the most basic forms of human interaction. It's really what we do when we want to advance our interests, but we need another party to help do that. And that's when we are going to enter negotiation. The definition here that I use is drawing from Roger Fisher Billiard and Bruce Patton, who are sort of seminal negotiation theorists from the program on negotiation at Harvard, who write that it's the back and forth communication designed to reach an agreement when you and the other side have some interests that are shared and others that are opposed. So this idea of yes and no is sort of another piece that I want to kind of bring in here, that negotiation, this is just sort of getting to the synergy between negotiation and nonviolent action, or negotiation and civil resistance. So in, I used to work at the program of negotiation in Harvard, and we had an initiative there that was sort of trying to bring together these two processes that try to address conflict. And it, we had a seminar where we had Gene Sharp and Bill Urey, the author of Getting to Yes, together, and they were sort of dialoguing about these two processes. And Bill Urey made a statement that I think that has something interesting to say about the synergy of these two processes. So one of the key words that the field of negotiation revolves around is yes, a kind of getting to yes agreement. Perhaps the key word in nonviolent action is no, no to injustice. And we need both yes and no in this world. Yes without no is appeasement, and no without yes is war. And those are the twin problems we have to address in the world, particularly in the world of conflict. We need both yes and no together. So essentially just drawing on the idea that we need both of these strategies for successful and comprehensive social change. Similarly, you know, one of our role models in civil resistance and nonviolent action, of course, is Martin Luther King, and he also reflected on the possibility or the synergy between these two processes. So in his letter from the Birmingham jail, he I think really sort of outlines a framework for the importance of dialogue and the possibilities of dialogue, but only when then enough power has been garnered, has been created on the side of the resistors. So he writes, you may well ask, why direct action? Why sit-ins, marches, and so forth? Isn't negotiation a better path? You are quite right in calling for negotiation. Indeed, this is the very purpose of direct action. Nonviolent direct action seeks to create such a crisis and foster such a tension that a community which has constantly refused to negotiate is forced to confront the issue. It seeks so to dramatize the issue that it can no longer be ignored. The purpose of our direct action program is to create a situation so crisis-packed that it will inevitably open the door to negotiation. I therefore concur with you in your call for negotiation. Too long has our beloved South land been bogged down in a tragic effort to live in monologue rather than dialogue. So again, sort of pointing to the synergy between these two processes, but identifying the absolute critical importance of power on the side of the civil resistors. So the way I learned about negotiation was here at Fletcher and at Harvard, and the framework that that I was taught is this idea of integrative negotiation, which is sort of opposed to sort of more zero fixed sum framework of negotiation, which is what we think about with bargaining, where we're just sort of back and forth, like I gain, you lose kind of thing. And this idea of integrative negotiation is a framework that Bill Urey and Roger Fisher wrote about and sort of and tried to outline as a framework in which essentially the key piece here is getting to the interests, to moving from positions to interests. And the idea of, you know, the sort of the metaphor that they teach in negotiation, which is very simplistic in the scenarios that which you all are dealing, is the idea of an orange. You have a brother and a sister and they both want an orange, right? And so their position is, I want the orange. This brother's position is, I want the orange. The sister's position is, I want the orange. And those seem irreconcilable. I mean, they're mutually exclusive. But if you get to the interest, the sister wants the orange because she wants to make juice, and the brother wants the orange because he wants the rind to bake a cake. So if you actually got to the interest, you could see that both of their interests could be met through a negotiation. I understand it's a very simple scenario, and rarely is that going to be the kind of situation that you're all going to be dealing with. But I think that it illustrates this point of getting to the interest. So why you want your position? What are the needs, the aspirations, the concerns, and the fears which drive your goals? The other piece here, and of course, I is identifying who's at stake, who's going to be involved in a negotiation, both the people who you would actually be negotiating with, but also the secondary parties from which they're drawing support, and also from which you're drawing support. I think yesterday you had a presentation about Gandhi's negotiations with Viceroy Irwin, and he, arguably was not enough in touch with his secondary parties, with his movement, and so he was negotiating directly with the Viceroy, but and somehow a bit divorced from the movement from which he was drawing.
No, actually, we didn't discuss about that.
Oh, you didn't?
In leadership session,
okay.
Because that was supposed to be leadership session. Yeah, so okay. If you would like to. venture on that.
Okay. Well, the example is just that Gandhi was, you know, had some shortcomings in his negotiation strategy with Viceroy Irwin, and that he went in to negotiate, but in some ways was not. He put all his energy into the negotiation, and sort of the result was the movement lost some of its strength because they were told to stop, to not keep up their resistance as strong as they should have. And then in the end, the viceroy sort of got a lot of his interests met in the negotiation, and the Gandhi did not. And meanwhile, the movement had also really slowed down its resistance during that time. And so the negotiations is an example of how Gandhi was perhaps not the best negotiator and was a bit out of touch with his secondary parties. other pieces here, another critical piece of this integrative strategy is this idea of BATNA, which is the best alternative to negotiated agreement. And really, this is the alternative action that you can pursue away from the negotiation. That's what BATNA is. What's the best thing you can get if you can't get it through dialogue with your opponent? And the idea with BATNA, or using that as sort of a mechanism in negotiation, is that you want to constantly be assessing your BATNA and assessing that of your opponent. And you want to be strengthening your BATNA, and you want to be sort of whittling away at the BATNA of your opponent. Some questions that you might ask to sort of assess your own BATNA as a civil resistor: to what extent and how will we sustain resistance? To how will we respond to repressive action by the opponent? How solid is our coalition? How could it be broken up? What kind of support do we have? What kind of resources do we have? Those are kinds of questions that, if you're answering those and you're feeling strong, then that means your BATNA is quite strong, and that you have a good, you go into this negotiation with more leverage, essentially. You have something else to fall back on if you can't get your interests met in the negotiation. Meanwhile, you want to assess the BATNA of your opponent. And so questions there you'd be thinking about are: what are their pillars of support? Who are their allies? What are their resources? What are their police and military capacity? What's their control of the courts? What's their control of the media? And again, the lower that the answers come back on those pieces for them, the stronger position you have going into the negotiation. So that also sort of just falls right into the sources of leverage, the BATNA. Another source of leverage is appealing to principle, right? I mean, there's some opponents you may negotiate with where, you know, appealing to something like fairness might actually matter, to a precedent, to something that's happened before, to an international law. Those are things that can be possibly drawn on as a source of leverage, as well as, I think, media and international attention to a particular scenario is also a big point of leverage. In South Africa is definitely, I think, what helped move along the negotiations between Mandela and the Nationalist Party, was the idea that South Africa was becoming quite isolated economically, and there was a push. The ANC had done such a good job sort of building their case internationally, building a coalition, that the Nationalist Party really had a need to have to talk to them, because they were starting to lose economically. And then the last sort of piece here in this kind of strategy of negotiation is this idea of generating options, and then criteria for evaluating. So, you know, you want to create options that can try to, you know, address the interests of all parties, essentially, but definitely your own. And then you need to find a process to sort of evaluate those options. So a few other things here I would like to touch upon. One is this idea of how do these two processes of negotiation and civil resistance actually work together? And Gene Sharp writes about these mechanisms of change. And he, in some of the readings you may have done or you will do in the future, identifies four external mechanisms of change. So these are the ways that he believes or sort of articulates that nonviolent action actually brings about social change.
Excuse me, Amy, if I'm good. Yeah. It's important to give credit to scholars. However, the fundamental work is done by George Leahy.
Okay, thank you.
But he identified only three mechanisms of change. Okay. Gene Sharp added the fourth.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Okay, so Gene Sharp is drawing on George Leahy, who is an American scholar, or not American activist and scholar, on nonviolent action. So the mechanisms of change that these gentlemen talk about, the first is this idea of conversion, right? So that eventually a civil resistance movement is going to achieve change by converting your opponent. And this is this idea that the opponent will be sort of emotionally moved to understand your goals and your interests and therefore come to see the light and make some changes. This is unlikely, it has happened, but it is an unlikely scenario, and it's not one that I imagine that you all are concentrating on in terms of the ways you're learning about civil resistance. The second piece is accommodation. The idea that the opponent, there's a power shift. There's enough, the civil resistors have gotten enough power that the opponent, there is a shift of power, and they recognize that they've lost some power, and they're willing to sort of make an accommodation to meet some of the interests of the civil resistors. But it's not a full power shift. It's not that the civil resistors are now in power and the former opponent is no longer in power, but it's accommodating some of the interests of the civil resistors. The third piece here is nonviolent coercion, which is the idea that that mass resistance, the civil resistance has gotten to such a loud echo in society that it changes the political and social situation and the power regime, so that the regime can know, or the opponent can no longer rely on its infrastructure as it did before. And so there is some crumbling away at the existence of the opponent. And then the fourth piece here is disintegration, where the civil resistance is so strong that they have eroded all the pillars of support to the point where the opponent literally, the regime completely falls and breaks. And the civil resistance generally are the ones who come into power in that situation. So he sort of, these gentlemen articulate this theory for how this social change happens. And then they have another piece around coalition building, this sort of social change that happens within your side, within the movement, within the civil resistance coalition. But I'm going to focus on two of the external mechanisms of change in which I think negotiation has a particularly important role to play. And the first is this idea of accommodation, right? So the opponent basically comes to a position where there's a power shift and there's a change in perspective. And the opponent recognizes that they need to make some accommodations, they need to make some changes. So one of the examples I'd like to draw on here is really in South Africa. This was a negotiation of the civil resistors, the ANC, with the direct opponent, with the Nationalist Party. And it is, these negotiations that were largely headed by Nelson Mandela began in the mid-1980s. And they were sort of, Mandela was still in prison at this point. And the regime originally tried to sort of isolate Mandela, move him to another prison, try to give him certain privileges that would maybe buy him to come to their side. They had gotten to a point where South Africa was becoming, the resistors had gotten so strong that it was becoming a bit ungovernable. And the UDF was very strong in South Africa at this point. Armed struggle was loud and alive, and the Nationalist Party, realized that they needed to make some accommodations. So these negotiations went on for several years, and there was talks about the armed struggle, about the ANC's alliance with the Communist Party, about the nationalization of the economy, and also about the protection of group rights under a scenario of black majority rule. But essentially, through all of these negotiations, the Nationalist Party was never in a position where they were ready to sort of release or be forced to release all of their power. They were accommodating the interests of the ANC, and when de Klerk started making several reforms in the very late 1980s, early 1990s, he freed key African Nationalist Congress leaders, and he lifted the ban on the ANC, but he did not intend to get himself out of power. He was very much still going to be the president. And so this was an example of really of accommodation, of the way negotiation was playing a role alongside the civil resistance in a change in society in South Africa, but it wasn't a full-on change in terms of moving towards nonviolent coercion or disintegration, but it's an example of accommodation. And then the other example I just want to mention briefly is an example of nonviolent coercion, which is a negotiation that occurred in Serbia between Otpor and the pillars of support of the Milosevic's regime, which at this, and in particular with the police and the military. So this was, and this idea, you know, this model of nonviolent coercion is that mass resistance, you know, changes the political and social situation, the power relationship to such an extent where the regime can't rely on its infrastructure anymore. They're a bit more coerced into meeting the interests of the civil resistors. The challenge is too widespread to control. So I think you guys watched the Bringing Down a Dictator, and I think there's a great example in there where on October 5th, 2000, when the convoys from around the country were descending upon Belgrade, and they're you know coming on the roads, and there's an example of the mayor of Čačak approaching a barricade on the road, and he comes out with his comrades, and they have a dialogue with the police about, you know, they want to pass on and pass forward to Belgrade, and there's a bit of a negotiation there, and essentially the police come to a point where they say, you know, they're going to build those barricades, but they're not going to defend them, and that I think is an illustration of how that moment is a negotiation that the civil resistors had with the police and authority, but it also is the symbolic of lots of negotiations that had happened leading up to that, in which the movement was very much trying to address the needs and the interests of the police and the military so they could sort of build a coalition, really, and they could, that their movement could be a way to move forward the interests of the police and the military, and in a way that police and military were no longer going to respond to the orders of their bosses, of the Milosevic regime. So this is an example, an illustration of how nonviolent coercion occurs when there is negotiation alongside civil resistance. So one of the key, this sort of a key question that I think those of us who are interested in pursuing negotiation in our civil resistance struggles is really, is negotiation our best strategy now? This is a tool, one tool of many for civil resistors. And it really requires, you know, a clear evaluation of your leverage and your power. It is not a good idea to go into negotiation if you feel that your BATNA is very, very low and that of your opponent is very, very high. And we draw on this idea of conflict ripeness, that conflict is like a fruit, and that if you pick it too early, it's too sour and bitter, and if you wait till late, it's mushy and it doesn't have the flavor that it should. And so it's really about calculating, is this the moment? Are we at a point at this time to enter negotiations? I find a really excellent example of this in the Force More Powerful Nashville segment. And that after the sit-ins and the boycotts and the marches that took place in Nashville to desegregate the lunch counters and you know desegregate the society, they had gotten to a point where the students were able to enter a dialogue with the mayor. And there's this key moment at the end of the segment where Diane Nash turns to Mayor Ben West and says, "Do you feel that it is wrong to discriminate a person solely based on the color of their skin?" And he responded, "I could not agree that it is morally right." And she proceeded, "Do you feel lunch counters should be segregated?" And he responded, "Yes." Now that was only possible, that negotiation, which was critical in terms of having the authority accommodate some of the interests of the students, that was only possible because of all the work the students had done, all the civil resistance that had happened for the months and days leading up to it. But I think they were very calculated in asking that question at the moment they did. They knew that they had a space to move forward. The last thing I just want to touch upon briefly is when we think about these two processes, negotiation and civil resistance, you know, what are some of the skills that are required? And are they different? Are they fundamentally different? you, I believe, are going to have a session on skills related to civil resistance and nonviolent action maybe after this. But even if you don't, you can check out Peter Ackerman's 2007 piece where he talks about some of the key skills involved. And he for civil resistance, he talks about the capacity of mass mobilization, of course, which requires leadership and organizing and clear goals. He talks about the capacity to marshal resources. And the capacity or the skill of maximizing disruption while remaining nonviolent, while keeping that discipline alive. And negotiation skills, I think there is definitely some overlap here. I mean, active listening is a key negotiation skill, and that's about listening and about reflecting back what you're hearing of your opponent. Articulate communication, and this is a lot about framing. It's about saying what you need, but saying it in a way that your opponent is kind of cornered into responding to your interests. I think Diane Nash's, the way she asked those questions to Mayor Ben West is an excellent example of articulating very effectively what she needed to, and framing that in such a way where he was positioned to look quite illegitimate if he didn't respond in the way that she asked him, in the way she wanted him to respond. Another key piece for negotiation, analytical thinking, really trying to get to the, you know, being able to think through a scenario and think about the interests behind the positions. And then, of course, innovation, which is obviously key to civil resistance as well. Being creative. What are some possible options for how we can address these interests? Now, one thing I think is interesting when you think about these two concepts, I mean, I'm trying to draw some parallels and some synergy about how they can work together. But I feel like one sort of difference that I think is fairly fundamental that I've observed in my studies and my my own work on these issues is this idea of the perception of the opponent. In the negotiation, and you do the training around negotiation, and the training around negotiation, it's very much about looking at your opponent as a possible partner. Together, you can build something. And in many of the scenarios that you are working on or that others are in the civil resistance struggles, we don't look at our opponent as possible partners. In fact, we look at them as very much as the enemy. And so I think if you can get beyond the language that negotiation uses, I think there are some tools that could be useful for civil resistance struggles. So I'm just going to say thanks very much. I look forward to your questions later, but I think we'll turn it over.
Well, I wanted to be more Socratic in my presentation and less visual than last time. But still wanted to emphasize a couple of studies that are, I think, relevant to our understanding of the impact of civil resistance on transition, and then maybe facilitate some of your feedback. But I wanted to start first from those two quotes. First one comes from one of the Polish Solidarity dissidents, who is right now a very successful entrepreneur, as Czesław Bielecki is, Adam Michnik, who says that those who begin by storming the Bastilles end up by building their own. And you know, we have always this default thinking that comes very naturally, that violence begets violence. Then whatever we achieve via violence, we'll need to maintain via violence. So there's always this thinking about the long-term impact of violence. And how about if we kind of reverse this and look at nonviolent resistance? If we have the same understanding of violence, perhaps nonviolent resistance might have also similar kind of force behind it in terms of its long-term impact. So perhaps we could look at the practice of nonviolent resistance and today's practice of nonviolent resistance and how the current practice of nonviolent resistance can impact nonviolent change and processes of nonviolent practices later during the transition. Reverend James Lawson pointed out during one of his numerous interventions during FSI to this issue of long-term impact of civil resistance. And civil resistance is not only here to resolve or to address oppression, but its force, its visual force, may continue and impact the changes later on. And I would like to focus on the kind of second part of this impact of civil resistance during the transition. But first of all, I wanted to call your attention to the work which you have right now with you by Erika Chenoweth and Maria Stepan. Actually, this book And this is, I think the information is not embargoed, at least I was not told not to say that, won the best award for, or the award for the best book on government, international affairs and politics by American Political Science Association for 2011. And this award will be given at the end of August this year. It was announced only a couple of weeks ago. So political scientists are recognizing the importance of the study of nonviolent resistance. I think it's a really major breakthrough in terms of the field that is being recognized by political scientists, known of the focus on structures and political issues. And this study provides important information about a long-term impact of civil resistance. It's one of the last chapters that they tackle this issue, and more studies are required really to understand, I think, the long-term impact of civil resistance, but they have fascinating data already. So as you can see, that was mentioned, they analyzed 323 nonviolent and violent conflicts in so-called maximalist struggles, the struggles that we would expect a lot of violence, which is struggles against dictatorship, against occupation, and for self-determination. And they look at what happens to the countries that experience both violent campaigns and those countries that experience nonviolent campaigns. What happens to them after the end of the struggle? And as you can see, they've got a really striking figures. That the probability that the country will be democracy 5 years after a successful nonviolent campaign is almost six times higher than for the successful violent campaign. And then probability that the country will relapse to civil war after successful civil resistance is almost twice, is almost two times slower than for violent campaigns. So then the question is that given this interesting data, the question is to explain why exactly I think civil resistance and which mechanism civil resistance might have such an important impact on whether the country will stay democratic after the struggle ends, or whether it will relapse to violent conflict. Another interesting study that I wanted to bring your attention to that was already mentioned earlier, but just to reemphasize the points. It was, actually there are two of them. Here you've got the button. The first one, How Freedom is Won, which was written by Peter and Peter Ackerman and Adrian Karatnitsky. And the second one, Johnstadt study that used the same set of data and analyzed not only political development of those countries that went through nonviolent resistance, but also the economic development of that country. And just to illustrate from where we started, I think speaking about civil resistance and democratization, this comes from Samuel Huntington in 1984, who said, "The democratic regimes that last have seldom, if ever, been instituted by mass popular action." We are way ahead right now, after 20 or so years of research and discussion about nonviolent resistance. So this study, the How Freedom is Won, looked at 67 transitions and that took place between 1972 and 2005. And they determined that 50 out of these 67 transitions were really driven by civil resistance, by strong nonviolent mobilization of people that push for change. The rest of those transitions were driven by elite-to-elite negotiations, or sometimes by external intervention. And they didn't look at what's going on in those countries, or with those countries, that went through either top-down transition, meaning elite-to-elite negotiations, or bottom-up transitions, these 50 transitions that were facilitated by some element of civil resistance force. So only 14% of the countries that went through the top-down transition are right now free, in comparison with 64% of countries that went through the bottom-up transition that are considered by Freedom House free. Again, this, I think, quite staggering figures comply or match the information that and the analysis that are provided by Erika Chenoweth and Maria Stefan in terms of interesting, at least on the surface, connection between civil resistance and the use of nonviolent actions and then establishment or building democracies in the future. The question would be, of course, to investigate what exactly makes civil resistance so propitious for democratization later on. But that's on the kind of general statistical and analytical level. So I wanted to come to more, I'll mention the second study briefly. So Johnston took the same data, but look at the economic growth in those countries. And in essence, he discovered that economic growth is higher in those countries that went through the nonviolent resistance before the change occurred. So 50% of those countries that went through the top-down experienced moderate and high growth in comparison with 80% of the countries that experienced this moderate and high growth for the countries which experienced this bottom-up transition, for the countries that had this civil resistance component bringing about change. So both the political transition and economic transition in terms of the successful kind of trajectories, they had a certain correlation between the successes and the presence of civil resistance that is taking place before the transition occurred. So I wanted to ask you, since we talk about the transitions, to identify right now the main challenges that you would see when you look at the systemic transition. So we don't, you know, we are kind of on the macro level, on the kind of state country level. If you look at the transitions, what are the main challenges that we face during transition, that we experience during the transition? If you can name a couple of them. Yes, sure.
But people have very high expectations of what needs change, and it may not always be realistic.
Yes, expectations are very high, particularly after successful nonviolent resistance. Okay, good. Yes, Rumi.
Sometimes it is not clear, for instance, what drives the leadership of the movement to negotiate. And so at the end of the day, some of the goals, or should I say objectives of the movement are not achieved. For instance, I'm thinking about the negotiations with Lancaster for Zimbabwe's independence. As much as those negotiations were pushed by the fact that the British had realized that armed struggle was not sustainable, and as much as they had seen that the more subtle ways in which Zimbabweans were resisting British imperialism through sailways and things like that was starting to have an impact on the economy, I feel largely that the leadership went to negotiate not because they felt it was the best way of acquiring independence, but because they felt it was the best way for them to ensure they secured positions of power within that transitional government.
Okay.
That would come
so if place. I was to generalize, it would be kind of disconnect between what political elites may wanted to achieve or what their goals were and what the public expected from them, which would be probably in similar kind of vein that Shireen mentioned in terms of public and maybe political elites disconnect. Yes.
Sometimes achieving something or things that are successful for ending conflict are not necessarily good for transition. So then,
I would say chaotic system maybe.
What?
The leaders are not really ready
just sometimes, like for example, in Bosnia, Richard Holbrooke went over and he negotiated all these things that helped end conflict. But if you look at Bosnia now, a lot of those things that were negotiated became handicapped a lot of the political system now. So they can't.
And why exactly were they handicapped?
So what ended the conflict was that they allowed the three major groups to have representation in the government. But now, as they're trying to develop and be sustainable, it's consistently gridlocked because they all have equal representation. They cannot actually negotiate.
Okay. So that would be the political. One could say that that was the division, among political elites, or fragmentation of the political scene. Could be one of the things that hinder transition, producing gridlock. Yes.
An overemphasis on security and stability, because there are concerns about chaos and descent into chaos, and there can be kind of a bit of overemphasis on sort of securing areas and making it a stable system. And it doesn't really, when you emphasize that, you look towards old structures, you look towards old systems, and you don't actually look at why the transition happened. So it can create a system in which you're looking for stability over governance, the rule of law, justice, and it can sort of embed corruption in the old elites.
Could be the issue of the priorities in terms of reforms. What first to kind of tackle? What is the major issue? Is it a constitutional reform that we need to deal with, or perhaps economic crisis that we have in our hand?
Yeah, political expediency and stability over anything else.
Yeah, let's move ahead. And a couple of things you did mention, I identified some other as well. First of all, some people would point out to this issue of kind of lack of democratic culture, that there is this democratic disjuncture between society and elites. Some people would say that elites may be, in some cases, may be more ready to implement democracy than the society is in the way they understand democracy. And in other cases, it's the society that is more ready to push for change, for democratic change, than the elites are. The presence of old gods, that's a recurring problem that we see, that I want to preserve the powers. And it's maybe not so much the problem with the old guards of politicians, because those politicians would enter into competitive elections, usually during the transition. So they need to moderate their behavior, they need to present themselves to the voters differently when they were part of the undemocratic regime. But the issues with bureaucracy and military that are not electable, that they are not accountable directly to the people. And oftentimes they secretly wait for power and for preserving the influence. Oftentimes, the presence of political violence, economic crisis, fragmented and polarized political class. With the fragmented and polarized political class, we oftentimes have the issue of, or the problem of, unstable government and frequent elections. On one hand, that might be good. There is a kind of, maybe there is a change of the of the politicians with kind of new ideas are coming. But oftentimes for kind of continuation of the economic reforms and political reforms, you need to have more stability perhaps than changes in the government. So you keep the same kind of experts in place rather than replacing them after a couple of months. There is also a short window of opportunity for change and for implementing reforms. And that comes perhaps from the Polish example, where the government had really a couple of months to implement radical reforms before this window of opportunity would change, before this kind of enthusiasm of the change itself would die down, and people would then reject the more radical reforms because they were becoming more and more apathetic and critical of the government actions. Sometimes you've got political leaders that advance on the wave of nonviolent resistance, and they are advancing without really agenda for reforms. They don't have blueprint for action when they come to the government. They had blueprint for action in terms of resistance, but that's about it. They didn't have any agenda for reform when they managed to get to formal powers. There is oftentimes this disagreement and a lot of tensions in terms of what to do with perpetrators of violence from the old regime. And this kind of there's a waste of energy and time talking about the transitional justice, why economic reforms and perhaps the issue of security needs to be addressed first, whereas this discussion about transitional justice may have taken place much earlier during actual resistance. And so the time is then not wasted when the transition occurs. Finally, the issue of demobilized society, the civil resistance propels political elites to power, and then everyone goes home. And everyone expects deliverables. Everyone expects, you know, to get help, to get food, to get work on the table, and they don't do anything. They become demobilized. And generally, the transition is really the produces the moment of considerable uncertainty. So the way and in terms of quality, the movements prepare for the transitions. They are better in terms of addressing effectively these uncertainties that are listed on those two slides. So, quickly, what factors play a role in successful transition then?
Can I have a question on the previous one?
Sure, yeah.
Like, when I look at Sudan's struggle back in 1986, I think one of the biggest challenges was that political parties, and this is, you know, kept repeating itself, were very weakened. And they didn't have enough time to gain strength during this very short transition time, where the military institution, on the contrary, was very, very powerful. And that was one of the factors that, like, spoiled the whole thing, and we were back into...
Yeah, it's a great point, because then the weakness of political parties and the strength of this former power holders in bureaucracy and military points to the importance of the society staying still mobilized, because they are the only, perhaps, force, given that political parties are still weak, the political systems are still weak, the interest groups are still weak, as a kind of force to push bureaucracy and military, and eventually politicians, to implement radical reforms, particularly political parties that they usually have those tasks to do. They are quite weak. So, in terms of let's move because we don't have much time. But keep your question, and I will get to you first.
No, I just want.
Oh, there is another person. Okay.
No, I witnessed it. I witnessed different things. It's not in our case. It's not demobilized a society. You can see after 1998, more people, you know, believe that the civil resistance is powerful. That therefore they use it this.
I will get back to it.
So it's yeah,
I will get back to that. It will be on that slide, actually. So let's get some thoughts about successful transition. What do we need for successful transition?
Unity.
Okay.
Leadership.
A plan. Strong civil society.
Democratic institutions, prevent dictatorship from reconstructing itself very fast.
Active, democratic, and open civil society that prevents dictatorships from re-emerging.
Qualified team of experts in policy.
Experts with good solutions for the existing problems, or effective solutions.
Mechanisms or structures set up for transitional justice and community reconciliation processes, particularly atrocities that have been committed by the old regime.
Yep. Right. Restorative justice issues.
Yeah, if it's rooted in the grassroots, it's successful, and if it's imposed by, let's say, the UN.
Great.
One that I think bridges both challenges and factors in success is laws on the books about voting, about setting up a voting system that has integrity and verifiability. And that's not something that can be done perfectly in 3 months. And yet if you push it, and if you take a year to do it, the transitional authority may get too comfortable. If you do it too quickly, it may not have any integrity at all. So there's that middle zone between giving political parties enough time to build their strength, letting media actually establish itself, developing voting systems with integrity. That there's never enough time to do it perfectly, but if it's rushed, it doesn't work either. So you have to kind of get to a good enough place.
Right, time and content of those changes, they are important.
I'm teaching nonviolent methodology out of Gandhi in the 50s and 60s and since. It seems to me that a civil resistance movement needs to establish early a follow-up task force that begins to map out from the beginning.
I mean, we will get to this issue of what the movement should do in preparation for the transition. So then, Reverend Lawson, if you can then explain more on that point, that would be great, because that would actually be addressed in the later slide.
I think
Yes.
Just as it's linked to Adi's point, but institutional checks and balances that are built into the system that will prevent another abuse of power.
Right, yes. So checks and balances in the system that would prevent the abuse of power. Let's go ahead. Some people would say external influence. With that, they would add geographical proximity. This is the factor that we would have little control over, of course, of impacts. They would say that the countries that experienced successful democratization, they were the countries that were adjacent to democracies, or that actually received some help from democracies in terms of technical aid and technical advice on the during the transition. So, for example, they would say that countries in Central Eastern Europe, they had more probability for democratization or greater likelihood to become democracies than, for example, countries in Central Asia, because the countries in Central Europe were closer to democracies, and they were receiving also because of that much more aid in terms of helping the transformation than, for example, the countries such as Kyrgyzstan or Uzbekistan or Turkmenistan. Some would point to the issue of lower social cleavages and lower inequality, which would oftentimes be associated with successful economic reforms. They would point to the need for economic reforms, not so much emphasizing free market economic reforms, but economic reforms that would ensure more equal distribution of wealth to create, of course, the middle class, more stable middle class that would support the transition. Some experts and scholars talked about political tradition in terms of success, in terms of facilitating successful democratization. So the presence of, in history of the specific country, a presence of democratic transition, even if that was 50 or 60 or 70 years earlier, that there was a period when the country was democratic. There are actually studies indicating that those countries that had even the small window of opportunity to be democracies earlier, they've got better chances of being democracies later. Electoral infrastructure, what Hardy was also pointing out to this issue of setting up a structure that would ensure fair and free elections, right, sequencing of reforms, and independent media, pro-democracy leaders, so the ones that would be oftentimes more skilled in winning people's support than and advancing their democratic reforms than the residual forces from the former regime. The issue that was also highlighted here in terms of distributing the powers. So, for example, scholars are pointing out to Russia and saying that Russia, the democratization in Russia failed because the power was concentrated. And what was built was supra-presidential system in Russia that stifled democratization in that country. But they would also point to the fact that power should not be deconcentrated among different branches of the government, but the power should be also decentralized between communities, regions, and national level. And finally, civil society. And some people point to the fact that actually civil society should be quiet, that too much disturbances makes the transition more difficult. Too much pressure on the political leaders, disturb political leaders unnecessary. And it may actually hinder them, the successful transition. And finally, some people would say we need rebellious civil society. We need boisterous civil society in order to facilitate the transition. I will skip this. I will really just mention that quickly. You know, you can have different types of transitions. And we talked about the different types of mechanisms of change of facilitated by civil resistance. We can also probably problematize this issue of transition and civil resistance by looking at successful democratization, kind of democratization that is going on. And I think I think Kyrgyzstan may be this kind of meddling through democratization that is going on for 20 or so years, or some transitions that backslided. And then the question is, the role of civil resistance, the role of rebellious civil society in those three types of possible transitions. But we should, in terms of looking and judging civil resistance and its impact and its role during the transition, we should establish what are really the goals of civil resistance when it's taking place. Some people are talking about the two parallel struggles that the civil resistance is engaged in. The struggle to immediately take down oppression. That's the first struggle. And the second struggle that oftentimes civil resistors forget about that is the struggle that once this immediate oppression is taken down, the struggle continues in order to establish democracy and greater prosperity for the country. So oftentimes the goals, I think, of civil resistance movements are disreformative. They're attacking specific policy, specific oppression. It could be oppression that is kind of overarching, overwhelming. This could be oppression from a regime. But they are not really advancing these transformative goals. So for example, if one judges Orange Revolution in Ukraine and saying that they didn't bring about democracy that Ukraine is meddling through in that transition, the question would be, what was the initial goal of the Orange Revolution? Was it reformative or transformative? And my argument would be that it was transformative. The Orange Revolution is nothing to blame for because its initial goal was transformative, to address a specific injustice and policy which was about rigged elections. Of course, people's expectations were different. But the immediate goal was not kind of full democracy or Ukraine in EU, in European Union. The immediate goal was to have honest and free elections. So what can we learn from transitions, from the ones that we could observe? In Serbia, and Ivan can speak more to that, the activists wanted to become politicians. They quickly formed political party. What was the name of the political party?
Otpor.
Otpor, of course. Exploiting
the bread.
Right. And they worked hard. You know, they had all the infrastructure, all the experience from civil resistance. And they got, do you know how much they got during that election?
1.4%.
I thought it was 0.4.
1.67.
Oh, 1.67. So they were excellent resistors, excellent activists, but in terms of organizing political campaign, not so successful. Ukraine, and I think Maldives as well, and that came from, I think, my conversation with Hardy. After successful civil resistance, the society thought, we did the job. We're marvelous. And we're so good that right now we can go home. And let the leaders that we push continue the reforms. And Hardy told me that President Nasheed said that when Olena asked this question about why exactly he didn't go, or he wasn't so forceful with the remnants of the regime, either military or police or judiciary, when he took over the powers. His answer was that he thought that he could reform them. But then when Hardy talked with him, he also said one important thing, that we didn't push so hard on this remnants of the regime because we were not pushed ourselves by our society to do so. Mm-hmm. Our society went home. And they thought that we could do ourselves what was needed to do. Georgia is another interesting example of transition in terms of the connection between civil resistors. They all went to the government. Almost no one stayed in the civil society from those important activists. So the president Shakashvili is credited with a tremendous change, particularly on the level of corruption, that he reduced corruption immensely. But actually, a lot of Georgians are saying that he's not a democratic president as such. That he's using oftentimes methods that resemble his predecessor, Shevardnadze, methods in terms of dealing with political opposition. And oftentimes, people would point out to the fact that there was no powerful civic watchdog left in the society when all those activists went to the government. In the Polish case, there was one important, very powerful watchdog that was left, that was headed by Adam Michnik, from whom I had that quote at the beginning of my slide, which was a newspaper that became one of the largest Polish daily that in essence created this kind of watchdog function over the government, in addition to hundreds of NGOs that popped up immediately after the change. So in Poland, Egypt, and Tunisia, what I see and what I've seen in Poland was what some scholars refer to as rebellious civil society, continued mobilization. And as I mentioned, that some of the people are pointing out to this problem of the too rebellious, too radical civil society may actually create a backlash. That the old guard may actually feel threatened, and perhaps that would reinforce the authoritarian tendencies. But if we assume that the transition occurred because a number of civil society actors or a number of those resistors kind of, there was an opening for them to come to power through accommodation, through nonviolent coercion, then there are some actors in that government that need the society's kind of attention, that needs the society energy, that they could use in order to bolster the case for them radical economic and political reforms. So that's one thing. And then I think one would need to ask this question about the kind of benefit of rebellious civil society present during the transition. And this is about Egypt. Where would Egypt or Tunisia or Yemen, for the matter of fact, have been now without the continued presence of people on the streets and the ongoing engagement in collective actions during transition? My answer to that would be that they would be, particularly in Egypt, would have a complete overtake of the government and public space by the military. If there wasn't for the fact that the society state mobilized after the transition, they didn't go home like it was the case in Ukraine or like it was the case in Moldova. I think that there is certainly a need perhaps to change a mindset a bit and to adjust that mindset from the kind of immediate goal of fighting with the oppression, of fighting with the dictatorial regime, and which would be focused on these tactical and operational objectives, and more kind of specialized and technical nature of the work in terms of preparation for the reforms that the movement would eventually need to implement once in power. And this, in essence, this kind of shift between tactical and operational mode of operandi towards more specialized and technical, which would need to be done, I think, parallel, simultaneously. The part about specialized and technical preparation could focus on this building what I call alternative citizens government, or what in politics is called shadow government, where small groups of technical experts could be responsible for specific reforms that are needed to be implemented quickly when the movement comes to power. And you can, you know, each country has its own priorities. And this is just the list of possible technical teams that could emerge, pop up during the resistance. And actually the very fact that they exist, the very fact that they debate among themselves, this is a good thing. They are essentially those islands of democracies, technical democracies, before democracy is open to business when the resistance wins. They could already do this kind of democratic work, focus on technical issues, while developing this alternative citizens government. Another way of looking into preparation for democratization transition would be to build, parallel to the alternative government, building alternative civil society through different types of institutions that are needed anyway for waging resistance. These institutions or associations or cooperatives that are built autonomously from the government in order to liberate the society could be and are oftentimes important fertile ground for the emergence of NGOs and civil society organizations once the kind of legal framework is open for them to become legalized and kind of come out of the ground and underground to become kind of the support for civil society organizations. So one of the strategies of civil resistance movements is to build parallel institutions, not only to wage successful nonviolent resistance struggle, but actually to win the transition eventually. And develop also know-how of political campaigns, something that outdoor activists may needed to have before getting into politics. If indeed the movement, and also thinking whether the movement, the civic movement, should turn into political party, And if it should turn into political party, what is that exactly that transition means for the movement and for the activists? And I think they let's see, how to involve civic groups or trusted public institutions in specific reforms. Eventually, civic resistance, it's about public, it's about civilians, it's about civic kind of space and civic organizations. Oftentimes when those experts and technocrats come to power, you know, with the blueprint for action, they oftentimes implement reforms as if the public was not there, as if the civic institutions were not there. So perhaps one could think about specific reforms, let's say reform of the military, reform of the police, where different civic groups could be involved in that reform. For example, in the training, using public universities, using civic society organizations to train the police, to train the military, in thinking about the work that would not only be focusing on how to violently enforce certain issues, but how to take into consideration the kind of civicness and the civil society. So in Polish case, there were a number of civic foundations involved in decentralization reforms that the government pushed. And there were specific civic foundation that was training local officials and local bureaucrats in becoming kind of empowered in terms of carrying on the activities of the decentralized local authorities. And then help transform activists into skilled negotiators, into policy experts and politicians. And the question is also, of course, how to do that. Work out mechanisms to maintain unity. One of the problems during the transition that occurs within the movement is that the main enemy, the main opponent is gone, and the movement disintegrates. The unity is not maintained. And the question is, how to maintain that unity, coalitions, despite the fact that the opponent is no longer there. Preparing a plan for dealing with the remnants of the regime, and making sure that someone stays behind the movement when the movement enters power. So that someone, and encourage even that someone, to be the watchdog, to be the pusher of what we do in the government. And actually, usually those people who are not in the government, they have much more freedom in terms of expressing the discontent and disagreement with their colleagues that are currently in the government. The mentality of the politician is completely different from the mentality of civil resistance. And that needs to be recognized. And then ensure, of course, that people, in general, the society stay mobilized to enforce what I call popular accountability. When the political parties are weak, when that accountability cannot be done through different processes and procedures that we would usually expect to exist in democracy, to enforce that through in kind of direct people to politicians' contacts, oftentimes through nonviolent actions. And what I would probably advise maybe to President Nasheed, and I'm not sure that would work in his situation, would be to combine the benevolence of civil resistance with shrewdness of politics. And that depends on the context. So I will stop here. Thank you so much. I do apologize, we don't have more time for questions.